Sprouts Methodist Church on Sunday the 22nd of September for our 10:30 a.m. worship. And a special welcome for anybody visiting us today. I know we've got visitors. And it's very good. Please continue fellowship with us after the service with a cup of tea and coffee. And if you wish, there is a light lunch that you'd be most welcome to stay for as well. Right, okay, extra notices. Right, thank you for everybody who puts their name down on the list at the back for volunteering to read. If you're going to do that, can you try to have your name on the list by Thursday preceding the Sunday so that we can make sure we know who we've got to contact and so that we can sort that out. Thank you very much. Right, that's, apparently we don't have any birthdays that we know about. So are there any birthdays or special? Oh yes, we've got one.
That was yesterday.
Yesterday. And your name, sir, is?
Dennis.
Dennis, well you're very welcome and happy birthday for yesterday.
Thank you.
Can we sing? We can sing. Well, other people can, I can't.
That of our New Testament reading. for let us share in our call to worship. O Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You mark out my journeys and my resting place, and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word on my tongue, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. You encompass me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. prayer of adoration and thanksgiving, followed by a prayer of confession, assurance and forgiveness. These prayers to be followed by the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Lord of love, may we show the wisdom that comes from heaven, pure, peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Make us peacemakers who sow in peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. God of blessing and joy, thank you for your gifts, which are more than we can ask or imagine. Thank you for the gift of life, which is precious and sacred. Thank you for the gift of faith, which is a light in the darkness. Thank you for the gift of hope, which is an anchor for the soul. Thank you for the gift of love, which is the greatest of all. Thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, who is our friend, Lord, and Saviour. And God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have been envious and selfish, boastful and false, quarrelsome and violent. We have hurt others and ourselves and dishonoured you. Forgive us, O God, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Restore to us the joy of your salvation and renew a right spirit within us. God of grace and love, thank you for your forgiveness, freely given through the cross of Christ. Thank you that you do not reject us in our weakness, but welcome us in your mercy. Amen. Now the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going on a journey this morning. I just want to give you an insight into three journeys I had. Now this slide you see on the screen was a journey I took in 2014, in November 2014, to Perth, Western Australia. And this image depicts the Swan Valley and the river showing vineyards. What do we need to go on a journey that far away? Who needs a passport? Yes, one that is still in date, yes. Do you need any money? Yes. When you get there, do you need somewhere to stay?
Yes.
Luckily, I had all these. From Perth, we travelled on to Melbourne and spent a few days there. From Melbourne, we flew to Hobart in Tasmania, spent 3 weeks in Tasmania. On the way back, we went to Sydney. and from Sydney we flew to Kuala Lumpur, Amsterdam, back to Norwich. And I gather when we got home that in November 2014 you'd had an awful lot of rain here. In Australia it was their summer. I have another slide. This one was a journey that I made last year. My daughter took me to Spain, to Ibiza, for a week. And this is the Mediterranean Sea. We had a very relaxing week, which was good. I also needed a passport to get there, and I had to make certain that it was in date, because I'd got it originally for the Australian visit in 2014, so I just got in okay. But this year, on the next slide, anyone know where this slide was taken? Cromer. Yeah.
Good old.
Yeah, I went to Cromer on June the 29th, which would have been my 50th wedding anniversary. And it's the North Sea, we can see there. But we had a good day, the sun shone, and I actually got sunburned. And we were able to give a donation to the RNLI in memory of Ian. And all these journeys remind us that we, oh, and that particular journey I didn't have to pay for, I did it on a bus pass. That's but all these journeys remind us that we do also have a Christian journey. And the next hymn we're going to sing, which is 477, Teach Me to Dance to the Beat of Your Heart. We're encouraged to move in the power of the Spirit, walk in light, love, trust, and hope as we praise God. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
they and their teachers have a good time this morning on their own Christian journey. We're going to see a video now called The Journey of a Lifetime, The Methodist Way of Life. And it's going to introduce to you what is the Methodist Way of Life. And it's this little pocket guide is related to the video that you're now going to see.
God loves you unconditionally, no strings attached. Maybe you've heard the gentle, loving voice of God, not like any human voice, but something far more subtle that speaks directly to your soul, that says you are loved and seen. Responding to God's voice is a lifelong adventure, a bit like a train journey. This can be scary, but nothing else in life is as satisfying. Staying where you are is an option, but you miss out on so much. What if you joined in with God's adventure? What if you started a journey not really sure what was going to happen or where you might end up next, with an open ticket for unlimited travel? What's important is deciding to get on the train and committing to the journey. There might be specific moments in your life that stand out, like the day you first said yes to Jesus. That's like stepping on the train for the first time. Or maybe you're just thinking about starting the journey now, but it's also a daily commitment to keep traveling in good times and bad. But where does the train go? What does this journey involve? There's a map. We call it a Methodist Way of Life. Each station on the way represents a different spiritual practice we might do, a different way we can encounter God. Some stations will be familiar to you, but some might be new. The train takes us to the pray station. We talk with God back and forth like a conversation with a friend. And we can be aware of a deep sense of awe surrounding us all day long. We serve people around us who need our help. And we can meet God in them too. We worship God, offering our praise and thanks and apologizing for the times we messed up. We can worship alone and with other people. Together, we receive forgiveness and mercy and become a supportive community. We notice God in the Bible and the world around us. God is findable, but not completely. We share our faith. We get to be God's partners in bringing love and restoration to the world. We challenge injustice. God is passionate about liberating people from whatever's oppressing them. We are open-hearted and minded, generous in giving and receiving hospitality, and we realize that God is like that too. We learn more about the journey of faith and grow and change to be more like Jesus. We care for each other and ourselves. Love for each other is at the center of this journey. We live in a way that draws others into the journey with Jesus, being transparent, warm, and ultimately being yourself. You be you. We do what we can to help the natural world flourish. God loves it all. And we tell others about what's happening to us on the journey. Your story matters. Most of us find it easier to meet God at some of the stations. We might have a home station. That can be a good thing. A recognition of our gifts and passions. It's good to grow these. But sometimes we become so comfortable there that we're not sure we want to explore the rest of the network. There might even be some stations we actively avoid. Perhaps we've had a bad experience before, or we're not confident we know what to do at the station. But traveling to new stations is an exciting way to get to know God better and to learn from other travelers. The good news is we don't travel alone. We can share our stories with God and with each other. As we journey, it's good to chat and reflect on our adventures and encounters, both good and bad. When you reflect, notice what you feel. What feels deep or true? What are the times when you get a sense that there's more going on beneath the surface, that the universe is humming with love? It's also good to do something creative to help you remember. The act of writing or scrapbooking, or writing a song, or painting, or baking, or sewing. Whatever it is, that's your thing. Like even getting a tattoo to remember big moments. Actions like these help us to make sense of what happened, and it's amazing how much we forget otherwise. All of this conversation and reflection can help you to recognize God at work in the world, which God is, but it's so easy to miss. How will you respond to God's love today? Are you up for a train journey? And what if you're already a seasoned traveller? Are you up for visiting some new stations?
We sing again, number 673. Will you come and follow me if I but call your name?
I have spent my strength in vain and for nothing. Yet what is due to me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God. And now the Lord says, he who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength. He says, it is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring my salvation to the ends of the earth. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from John's Gospel, chapter 13, beginning at verse 31. Jesus predicting Peter's denial. When he was gone, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified with him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now. Where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Simon Peter asked him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus replied, where I am going, you cannot follow now, but you will follow later. Peter asked, Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Then Jesus answered, will you really lay down your life for me? I tell you the truth. Before the cock crows, you will disown me three times.
Just need to close your eyes for a couple of seconds and imagine that the sermon has been preached and the service is over. Well, I can't believe it.
Neither can I.
What an absolutely awful sermon.
Quite. I'm not sure we should go back there again.
Indeed. We were to take the murk elsewhere.
And at the beginning, I thought it was going to be a nice little talk about love.
That's what I thought. It started off well enough.
Yes. Lots of kind thoughts about being nice to animals and thoughtful to children.
Well, yes. As long as it's not that rabble from the school on the estate.
Oh, absolutely. They're terrible. Shouting and swearing. And they look so dirty too.
Lairbakes. There are a lot of them. But the sermon, that's promising. Not too controversial, I suppose.
Nothing too religious, just nice and sweet.
And then she had to start on about prejudice.
As if that's got anything to do with love.
Quite. What did we need to hear about tramps and beggars for?
I see enough of them when I go to town. They're all over the place, sitting on the ground with signs propped up, or selling that newspaper thingy.
Yes, it's the, oh, the big issue! Yes, remind me to write that letter to the council complaining. It'll learn the tone of the neighbourhood.
It certainly is. And as for the rest of the sermon, well...
She seemed to think that we were prejudiced against everybody. I mean, I don't have a problem with old people. I mean, that dear old lady sits in front of us. That church is really... quite sweet, I suppose. And I only blared my horn at that old man on the way here because the silly old fool was going too slow and was in my way.
Yes, and I thought he was going to have a heart attack afterwards.
Yes, it was quite amusing, that wasn't it?
I thought so too. But really, the thought that we might be prejudiced is preposterous.
Not only that, but to suggest we aren't loving? I'll have a dog collar for that.
And to say that every time we show a lack of love, it's harmful to the kingdom of God? She's gone too far. I like lots of people, except the old.
Oh, and the young. Hooligans, a lot of them.
And tramps and down and outs.
Oh, and the French.
And don't forget the working class.
Apart from them, we like lots of people, don't we?
Yes. How dare she accuse us of lack of love?
We're great adverts for Christianity, aren't we? Yes.
Well, what about the sermon? Let's see. I wait for thoughts afterwards. Together in discipleship, we're learners, we're followers, and we're messengers. Let's start with learners. Who learned anything at school? Yes. No, some. No. But when you left school, did you think, ah, thank goodness, that's the end of learning. I haven't got to learn anymore. No, it didn't work out like that. No, learning is a lifetime experience. And Jesus' disciples in John's Gospel listened to his word. And we do as well. And we receive teaching from Jesus as the giver of spiritual nourishment. We imitate and learn from him as we experience the call to real discipleship. Reverend Andy Burroughs, in his introduction to this series at the beginning of September, spoke of mission statements, and together in discipleship is our mission. The Methodist Church came into being as a discipleship movement, and before the time of Jesus, the word disciple had been used to describe apprentices who were learning a trade. In Jesus' day, it was associated with the disciples of a rabbi who would even live under his roof during the period of their training. However, today we have an interpersonal process of discipleship, being helped to learn and grow, to become more like Jesus, and to fulfill our calling to serve. The word disciple means, above all, learner or pupil. The Methodist calling to learning and caring contains three practices: learn, care, and openness. While these are commitments we can practice and receive with all people, they particularly relate to how we connect and form community within the community of believers. Those who have committed to exploring a relationship with God. This does not just mean Methodist members, but may include people who attend groups run by the church, or friends and neighbours who are spiritually seeking but would not call themselves Christians. The commitments help us to support each other, both practically and spiritually. John Wesley, founder of Methodism, always had a restless desire to be a better disciple of Jesus Christ, to grow and mature in the faith. and this is an example we should follow. In an age of social inequality, grinding poverty and great need, many people felt dehumanized, alienated and powerless. But everyone matters to God, which is why Wesley's preaching touched the lives of thousands with a message of hope. Salvation is not dependent on social standing or moral virtue. It's a gift available freely to all. This all is what gives Methodists a passion for evangelism and inclusion, including people marginalized by society. If this is true, it should inform how our learning affects our practice. Learning is not just about facts. Faith is a physical, intellectual, spiritual, and emotional journey. Wesley emphasized that the Holy Spirit helps us to realize our need of God, come to discover Him, and then receive the assurance of His acceptance, love, and forgiveness. This is not the end of our pilgrimage, but it is the end of our searching for the way. A Methodist way of life. What is it? A Methodist way of life, with God's help, we learn from it in worship, prayer, and through scripture and the world. We care for ourselves and those around us, learn more about our faith, practice hospitality and generosity. We help people in our communities and beyond. Care for creation and all God's gifts, challenging injustice. We speak of the love of God, live in a way that draws others to Jesus and share our faith with others. God calls all people and nations actively to work for peace and justice, liberation and transformation. No one can solve these issues alone, but we can work out together how to respond to the injustice we see locally or globally. The Methodist calling to service contains three practices: challenging injustice, serving others, and seeking the flourishing of all creation. These practices relate to how we commit to serve people and the world around us, both near and far. Wesley spoke of the means of grace, such as worship, prayer, Bible study, fellowship, and service. These help us travel the way of holiness, the essence of perfect love for God and humanity. For Wesley, the stress on perfect love, which simply means Christ-like love, is paramount. There's three different approaches to evangelism in a Methodist way of life. Tell is about what we say, conversation with others. Share is about what we do, our loving actions with individuals and communities. And live is about being the image of God, naturally radiating love, God's love, to draw people to Jesus. We're called to live as people of light, reflecting something of the light of Christ wherever we are. A Methodist way of life has a natural rhythm, which has been compared to breathing. We breathe in the love of God and breathe out love of God and others. God loves you. We find that in John 13, Jesus here has his last opportunity to talk with his disciples. Soon they will be overwhelmed by the traumatic events of the night. He tells them that he's going to be glorified, not by being recognized, proclaimed, and crowned as king, but by going obediently to a disgraceful death on a cross. Jesus gives his disciples a new command, one which will be etched on John's memory for the rest of his life. It simply stated, love one another. What kind of love is this? Affection? Friendship? Lust? Jesus explains, it's the kind of love that I have for you. Loving God and loving neighbour were known since the days of Moses, but what is new is the standard of loving. Jesus shows his love for his disciples by serving them and laying down his life for them. It's the kind of love Jesus has for his Father and now extends to embrace the whole human race. Loving one another has been a struggle, almost an impossibility for the disciples. In the Gospels of Mark and Luke, we see their rivalry, jealousy, and conflicting ambitions. Now, says Jesus, they are to put one another first. We also find Peter here, high on enthusiasm, as he would do anything for Jesus. But by first light, Peter will have disowned him, not once, but three times. It's not easy being a disciple, but we must trust in God's revealing love. From Isaiah 49, we find Isaiah of Jerusalem, well described as the evangelical prophet. His ministry belongs to the 8th century BC, a period rich in forceful prophetic activity, as Amos, Hosea, and Micah also belong to this century. And the century itself was marked by traumatic historical events. Isaiah is called for service at a time when the throne of God is never unoccupied. The Lord God, who calls us to his work, is sovereign, holy, and merciful. In our short passage, God's servant Israel is compared to a distended and supposedly pregnant woman. God chose Israel, intending to display his splendor through her. Israel had failed completely in her role as a servant. Yet, as Isaiah developed the servant theme, we see that even so, God will display his splendor in his Old Testament people. That splendor will not be seen in what they have done, but in what the Lord has done for them. And it's the same with you and I. Our efforts to earn salvation are useless, yet God has chosen to display his splendor and beauty in us. His splendor is not seen in what we do, but what God does for us in Jesus Christ. The servant's task is to reveal God's glory to the nations and give light to the whole world as God's love is revealed. Together in discipleship, disciples are learners, followers, and messengers. So followers. So whose example should we follow? I'm reminded of a Kingdom Company job request. Would this be the job for you? Just imagine the advert. the Kingdom Company Unlimited. Staff wanted for immediate vacancies. No previous experience necessary. No qualifications required. All training on the job with highly qualified instructor. Terms and conditions. Applicants must be willing to travel. Sick pay, pension, not applicable. Meals included. Accommodation is flexible. Remuneration, profit sharing, spelt P-R-O-P-H-E-T, not P-R-O-F-I-T. Prospects, excellent with lifetime contract. No CV, references or interview required. So here we have Jesus in today's world, recruiting and training his team of helpers. The Kingdom Company Unlimited, referring to the Kingdom of God, with Jesus the qualified instructor at the helm. Jesus chose to recruit and train ordinary, available, and willing fishermen and tax collectors to share the good news of the message of the Kingdom of God. And this same Jesus still calls us to follow him today. Those fishermen became apostles in the early church and, in accordance with the command of Jesus, made disciples in the name of Jesus Christ and became witnesses to what they had seen and heard. We sometimes feel like we must do certain things or live a certain way to be a follower of Jesus, but nothing we do can make God love us more. God loves us unconditionally, no strings attached. Because of our commitment to God and with God's help, we try to live our lives being like Jesus and doing as Jesus would do. This is at the heart of the calling of the Methodist Church, to respond to the gospel of God's love in Christ and to live out its discipleship in worship and mission. Messengers. Are we messengers? There's a legend that recounts the return of Jesus to glory after his time on earth. Even in heaven, he bore the marks of his earthly pilgrimage with its cruel cross and shameful death. The angel Gabriel approached him and said, "Master, you must have suffered terribly for men down there." He replied that he did. Gabriel continued, "And do they know and appreciate how much you loved them and what you did for them?" Jesus replied, "Oh no, not yet. Right now, only a handful of people in Palestine know." But Gabriel was perplexed. He asked, "Then what have you done to let everyone know about your love for them?" Jesus said, "I've asked Peter, James, John, and a few more friends to tell others about me. Those who are told will tell others, in turn, about me, and my story will be spread to the farthest reaches of the globe. Ultimately, all of mankind will have heard about my life and what I've done." Gabriel frowned and looked rather skeptical. He well knew what poor stuff humans were made of. And he said, "Yes, but what if Peter, James, and John grow weary? What if the people that come after them forget? What if way down in the 21st century, people just don't tell others about you? Haven't you made any other plans?" Jesus answered, "I haven't made any other plans. I'm counting on them. I'm counting on them." 21 centuries later, he still has no plan, no other plan. He's counting on you and me. And high on God's to-do list is the evangelization of the world to spread his good news of salvation. His early disciples adopted his priorities and devoted themselves to reaching the world. Christ counted on them, and they delivered. Have we done, or are we doing as well? God calls us to examine ourselves again, to look especially at how Christian faith and the practices of Christian love and justice match up in our own lives and in the life of the world we live in. We're being challenged to check out how much our Christian faith manifests itself in our everyday life and work, in lifestyle, daily responsibilities, through our relationships, shopping habits, business practices. We're called to show the world that the Christian in this century, through the love of God, proclaims justice for all humanity. We must be determined to repent of the past, to turn our lives around and live a new life in Christ. Our new life involves loving God with all our heart, soul and mind and strength, and loving our neighbour as we love ourselves. Jesus said, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a German Lutheran pastor and theologian, who wrote the book in 1937, The Cost of Discipleship, gives us these words. "Only Jesus Christ, who bids us follow him, knows the journey's end. But we do know that it will be a road of boundless mercy. Discipleship means joy. In worship, in learning and caring, in service and evangelism, I pray that God will make you worthy of the life to which he called you." So together in discipleship, disciples are learners, followers, and messengers. Which part of the journey do you travel on? Amen. We're going to sing together number 249, Jesus, fill us with your love. Show us how to serve the neighbours we have from you.
Prayers of intercession.
And when I say, Lord, in your mercy, please reply with hear our prayer. There should be an image on the screen. That's the image, thank you. That was a display that was in the chapel at the Norfolk Norwich Hospital very recently. And as it's Peace Sunday, I thought it would be good to share it with you. The first part of our prayer is the prayer which is on the small card from there. So on this Peace Sunday, let us seek peace. Source of life and love, we pray for peace in our communities and throughout the world. We seek peace in our hearts, a peace that transcends all understanding, that heals all wounds, that reconciles all conflicts. Grant us the wisdom to seek peace, to pursue dialogue, to embrace diversity, to respect dignity, and to uphold justice. May we be blessed with peace, peace that is a gift and a responsibility, is a promise and a challenge, that is hope and reality. We commend to you those who are striving to make peace in Ukraine and in Israel, Palestine. Give them wisdom in their thinking, mercy in their action, and fairness in all that they do. Help us to be peacemakers. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Saviour, we pray for those making political and economic policy in our own country. Give them wisdom in their thinking, mercy in their action, and fairness in all that they do. We pray for the health service, for those who fear fuel poverty, all who are dependent on food banks. Embrace each one with your comforting love. Lord, in your mercy. Life-giving Spirit, we pray for our church and the church throughout the world, for all religious leaders and followers. Give them wisdom in their thinking, mercy in their action, and fairness in all that they do. We pray also for all congregations and communities of Christians. Give them a desire for unity, a passion for mission, and a yearning to make more followers of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Trinity of love, joy, and peace, we pray for all with particular needs at this time. For those who are sick, for those who grieve, for those who are lonely, for those who are despondent. Give them wisdom in their thinking, mercy in their action, and fairness in all that they do. We pray for those who offer counseling, medical care, pastoral support, and love. Give them strength, comfort, and compassion in all that they are and do. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ over death and for the gift of eternal life. We pray for friends and loved ones who are with you in glory. O God, by your power, defend us and give us your peace. Amen. Amen. May we now please have the offering for the work of God in this church and in the wider world. we thank you for all the good gifts that you give to us. But we ask this morning that you would just take these small gifts of money and help us and the church and the wider world to use them wisely, showing your love to all people. Amen. Do not forget as you leave to take these little leaflets that remind you of this morning's service and also what the Methodist way of life is all about. We now sing our concluding hymn number 693, Beauty for Brokenness, Hope for Despair.
Suffering world.
grace together.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God.